Hello and welcome to the Import Export Hub channel. Bogdan here, your host for the next couple of minutes. And guys, let's not lose precious time here with lengthy intros, as I'm sure that you all know what to do with the like and the subscribe buttons. And first things first, let's start with a quiz question for this week. So here we go. From where did the United Kingdom imported the most in terms of value in 2020? And the options here are China, the United States, or Germany. And the correct answer is China, with close to $75.5 billion worth of imports. And for your information, guys, Germany was the second biggest partner with $74.4 billion, while the United States were the third biggest partner with $58.2 billion. Now, following up on two interesting developments, the first one is related to who is the number one shipping company in terms of existing capacity. And guys, here Maersk is still the number one operator in terms of existing fleet, almost 11,000 TEUs ahead of Mediterranean Shipping Company. So it seems that Mr. Aponte didn't make the acquisition just yet, or maybe, I don't know, the acquisition is done but not publicly revealed, and maybe he's waiting for Santa Claus to deliver this wonderful news, who knows. Because last week I saw a lot of headlines in which MSC was presented as the biggest operator, but my long trusted source of information in this respect, which is Alphaliner Top 100, still considers Maersk the biggest operator. So guys, pay close attention to what you read. The second quick follow-up relates to the container dual fees in the ports of Los Angeles and Long Beach. And it seems that they've postponed it yet another week until December 20th, which is not surprising really, as I've said in one of my previous videos. But anyways, moving on to the newsreel for week 49 here. In terms of freight, the Freightos index is currently at $9,550. With big movers in the Europe to South America West Coast sub-index, who was up 22%. Another big mover was the index connecting North America East Coast to North Europe, who was down 16%. While in terms of the major sub-indexes here, of course, I will cover just the Trans-Pacific and the Cross-West ones. For the Trans-Pacific ones, we have $14,924 for the one connecting China to North America West Coast, while the other Trans-Pacific in sub-index connecting China to North America East Coast is currently at $17,195, which is 3% more than the previous week. As for the Crosswell sub-indexes, China to North Europe sits at $14,498, while the sub-index connecting China to the Mediterranean is up 2%, bringing the absolute value to $13,424. And guys, with the sub-indexes being covered, I will deep dive into the news here. Lots of them for this week, and I will try to pass through them as quickly as possible and highlight the only the main ideas. So here we go. The first one comes from Splash 24/7, and it's about the Ocean Shipping Reform Act, as it seems that the House of Representatives in Washington DC passed a bipartisan bill designed to strengthen shipping supply chains. And basically, this bill, if it will pass also the Senate, will require that shipping companies adhere to minimum service standards that meet the public interest and blocks them from unreasonably declining cargo. The bill also touches the much debated detention and demurrage fees and other critical points incurred in the ocean shipping activity. I won't go through all of them. You have the link to the full content of the bill in the description below. But I will highlight here the feedback coming from John Butler, which is the CEO of Liner Lobbying Group World Shipping Council, who says, and I quote here, "The bill is a political statement of frustration with supply chain challenges, frustrations that ocean carriers share. The problem is that the bill is not designed to fix the end-to-end supply chain congestion that the world is experiencing, and it will not and cannot fix that congestion. End of quote. And here, guys, I'm going to make only one comment. How does the ocean carriers share the frustration of the small and medium importers or exporters? How can they put themselves in the shoes of these importers and exporters? Is $1,100 billion aggregate profits frustrating for the ocean carriers? I don't know. Is the shopping spree in the last year frustrating? Come on, guys. Where was the World Shipping Council, and what were you doing when the Federal Maritime Commission invited you to an overview of the port congestion and related international supply chain issues back in 2015? Because I'm fed up with this kind of approaches, and frankly, answering with this kind of arrogance, it only makes things worse for the World Shipping Council, if you ask me. And just for your information, guys, in order to see how active the World Shipping Council is in its lobbying activities, I have here the profile on the European Union Public Register of lobbying groups, and also the last meetings held. And we see how the WSC was very, very prolific back in 2019 when the consortia extension was approaching, and which, by the way, is still extended until April 2024, if I'm not mistaken. And also here, I'm really, really curious to know what did they discuss on November 19, so a couple of weeks ago, during the conference call with Roxana Lesovic about the evolutions of the maritime sector. And you're telling me that the ocean carriers are frustrating? Come on, this is space shit, and I'm not going to buy this crap. Anyway, I'm getting frustrated here with all this hypocrisy. I don't want to damage my brain cells with this, so I will move on to my next news, which concerns Maersk intended disinvestment in its refrigerated container unit manufacturing facility from China and the sale of this business unit to China International Marine Containers, as it seems that Germany's Federal Cartel Office is taking a closer look at this planned sale. So basically, until the regulatory authorities approve the sale, the two companies remain separate. And guys, as soon as I have new info available about the findings, I will follow up on you. As from my point of view, this is a news worth following up. But until then, I'll move on to my next one, coming from CNBC.com. And involves Amazon, who quietly for 2 years now, it's building its own fleet of 53-foot shipping containers and chartering its vessels in order to support the small and medium Chinese exporters who sell on Amazon, and of course who opt for the fulfillment by Amazon services. The article covers more about the subject, of course, with some insights from industry specialists. So if you want to have an in-depth knowledge about how Amazon is navigating the current supply chain disruptions, I highly suggest you to read the entire article. As I'll move on to my next one, coming from containernews.com, and it's about the newly formed China state-owned logistics group, which is called, guess what, China Logistics Group, who aims to become the global supply chain organizer by developing international trade links, freight services, and cross-border e-commerce. The newly formed company was created by the merger of China Railways Materials, China National Materials Storage and Transportation Group, Huamao International Freight, China Logistics, and China National Packing Corporation. There are also some strategic investors here, like, I don't know, China Eastern Airlines, Costco Shipping, and China Merchants Group, who will hold shares percentages of 10, 7.3, and 4.9 respectively. This giant currently covers already 30 Chinese provinces, has a presence in five continents, and operates a fleet of only 3 million vehicles. So quite a behemoth being born overnight, basically. And guys, guess what? I won't be surprised to see this newly formed company being the sole provider of transport services and logistics services for, I don't know, Alibaba or Taobao sellers. I know that there is an agreement right now between Zim Shipping and Alibaba, but with this move, I think that Alibaba will be pressured, to say the least, in opting for this newly formed state-owned logistics group. I don't know, it's just a hunch, but time will tell if I'm right or not. The fact remains that China wants to tackle the established and powerful big boys doing business in and with China. And I think that it's a matter of time until we will witness strategic alliances between the big boys and the newly formed China logistics group. Anyways, moving on to the news, I have another one coming from containernews.com. This time it's about CMA CGM's acquisition of Ingram Micro's commerce and lifecycle service business units in North America, Europe, Latin America, and Asia Pacific. The value of the transaction, which is expected to close during the first half of 2022, is of $3 billion. And with this acquisition, along with the one of Cheva Logistics that happened back in 2019, if I'm not mistaken, we'll create the fourth largest global provider of contract logistics services and one of the world's leading end-to-end e-commerce services. And yes, Mr. Butler, now I see the frustration of the shipping companies. They are frustrated because this big acquisition have to be approved by the relevant authorities. And of course, it takes time and effort lobbying these authorities. So I really understand your point, or not. Of course, the acquisition will go through. And with this move, we see how the smart shipping lines, especially Maersk and CMA CGM, are creating some beachheads for their future growth, as I really think that if there is money to be made after the current Uber cycle will fade, the only place for them is on the land side. And from a business point of view, I can only applaud these two visionary shipping lines. But anyways, the shipping lines are frustrated, right, Mr. Butler? And I'll move on to my next news coming from the Lodestar.com, and it's about the Taiwanese shipping lines, so Evergreen and Yaming, who are not following the contractual stance of rival operators like Maersk and Costco, which are locking in customers to multi-year contracts. For example, Yangming's president Patrick Tu said that, and I quote here, "We have to consider customers' wishes. They may think freight rates may not remain at the same high levels over the next 2 or 3 years. However, if customers are sure rates will remain high in the medium term, we're open to discussing fixed rate contracts and duration," end of quote. Also, the same goes for Evergreen. They are open to discussions with their customers, while Costco, on the other hand, is expected to increase the proportion of its contract business on the main Asia-Europe route above 45% for 2022. And guys, I think that here we have to make a clear distinction between these shipping companies and their customers, and we have to think in terms of size. And my idea is that big exporters, big importers will be serviced mostly by the shipping lines, by the big shipping lines, like, I don't know, Costco, Maersk, or MSC, while the small and medium importers or exporters will be serviced more and more by the smaller shipping companies like Yangming here, Evergreen, or why not Zim, for example. This is the first thing that I wanted to cover. The second thing is related to multi-year contracts. And here, my advice to those big importers and exporters is to lock in contracts that are benchmarked against one of the main ocean freight indexes. so that the contracts can be reassessed accordingly, of course leaving some 7 to 10% space in terms of variability in the movement of the index before the reassessment kicks in. And yes, 2022 most probably will see the same freight levels as 2022, maybe a little lower, but not that much if nothing major happens. And my guess is that this will be the case also, unfortunately, for 2023, by which time the shipping companies will have paved the way for a new way of collaboration between them, as frankly, I don't see and I won't see the current alliance business model working, as more and more pressure is building up from the regulatory bodies worldwide, especially those from Europe and the United States. Anyways, this is of course a personal and biased point of view. I might be completely wrong here, but only time will tell what will actually happen. Until then, guys, I will give you another three articles to cover by yourselves this time. One is coming from supplychaindive.com and covers six strategies to ensure that supplies are delivered on time. The second article is coming from freightos.com, and it's basically an insight on a survey done on approximately 300 companies and how these companies managed to navigate the supply chain disruption so far. And the third one comes from Allianz Research, and it's an article about the global trade report focusing mainly on the United States, Europe and China. All the three articles are really, really interesting pieces to read and cover. And guys, with this being covered, this was the wrap up for week 49. I really hope that you've enjoyed. Don't forget to hit the like and the subscribe buttons. And as usual, until next time, keep your business safe. Thanks.